Welcome back. Hoping to inspire you to read the Bible every single day. Zero excuse, and well, I hope it's working. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 5 through 9 today. Man, it is going to be a good one. We're going to talk about women and magic. We're going to actually pull out two fellas in the Bible that are some of my favorite, Yannies and Yambries. But in my Georgia accent, Jannies and Jambries, that's what I'll call them. They're two magicians in Pharaoh's court, and they show up in a strange moment. And well, I want to talk about them today because it's intriguing once you learn why they are in the Bible. So let's just jump right in. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 5 through 9. Here we go. They will act religious, but they will reject the power that could make them godly. Stay away from people like that. They are the kind who work their way into people's homes and win the confidence of vulnerable women who are burdened with the guilt of sin and controlled by various desires. Such women are forever following new teachings, but they are never able to understand the truth. I'm going to let that soak in a minute. For those of you that don't know me, I live with all women, a wife and four daughters, for the last 29 years. So I'm going to read this verse again rather slowly and hope they hear it. Such women are forever following new teachings, but they are never able to understand the truth. These teachers oppose the truth just as Jannies and Jambres opposed Moses. They have depraved minds and counterfeit faith, but they won't get away with this for long. Someday everyone will recognize what fools they are, just as with Jannies and Jambres. Woo! Women and magic. You gotta love the Bible. But I'm smart enough not to talk about women. You say, why? Why won't you be bold enough to talk about women not being able to understand truth? Because I like meatloaf and cream potatoes, and I don't want to sleep on a couch. That's why. So, let's just talk about the two magicians, Jannies and Jambres. Historically, they are the two guys that were part of Pharaoh's court in the book of Exodus. If you don't know the story, I shall enlighten you. In Exodus chapter 1, all the way through, well, about 14, but we're going to pick out chapters 7, 8, and 9 today. Moses goes to Pharaoh to say, let my people go. You see, Pharaoh had enslaved God's people. There was several million of them, and well, they were his slaves. And so one day, Moses is out in the field, and a bush shows up and said, hey, Moses, I want you to go tell Pharaoh to let my people go. And so Moses travels over to Egypt to say, hey, Pharaoh, let my people go. And then Pharaoh says, okay, who said that? And Moses says, well, a talking bush told me. Well, it really wasn't a talking bush. It was God talking through a bush. And then he said, well, Pharaoh's going to ask me, and I just can't go up and say, hey, a bush told me that you need to let 3 million plus slaves go, so I need a name. And so God said, okay, well, tell Pharaoh my name is I Am. Not like he could have called Bubba or Doug, but no, I Am. So Moses shows up in Pharaoh's court and says, hey, knock, knock, I'm Moses, and God, my God, says that you are to let his people go. Some 3 million of them, you've enslaved them, and he's a little upset. And Pharaoh says, who? And he says, well, I am. And well, Pharaoh said, sorry, not going to do that. Just because a talking bush told me to do it, I'm not going to do it. Which makes sense, by the way. If a bush ever talks to you to tell you to do something, don't do it. But Pharaoh refuses to obey God. So now start the wars between the magicians and Moses, well, and kind of his cousin Aaron. And it starts out this way. Aaron throws his rod down on the ground, a stick of sorts, and it turns into a snake. And then the two magicians, Jannies and Jambres, throw their rods down and it becomes two snakes. And this is long before there was Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom. Or even Disney's CGI. Oh, these are real snakes on the ground. And so Aaron's snake is there. And then the magicians throw their rods down, and there's two rods. So now there's three snakes on the ground. And well, the three snakes on the ground, it's kind of scary. But Aaron's rod, which is a snake, eats the other two snakes. You got to love that one. But Pharaoh still said, no, I'm not going to let my people go, or your people. Kind of confusing on whose people. But I'm not going to let them go. So Moses says to Pharaoh, he says, well, God wants you to do that, so I'm going to do something else. And so then, insert, he takes his rod and touches the water, and all the water in Egypt turns to blood. But fear not, we're talking about magic here. So Jannes and Jambres do the same thing, and well, they turn the water into blood too. You got to love that. In other words, Moses turned the water into blood, and then the magicians came along and did the same. In other words, they made it a little worse than it already was. But the blood stayed there 7 days, and the magicians could do nothing about it to change it back to water, so they just kind of had to wait around a little bit. And Pharaoh still said, no, I'm not very impressed with your little stick-to-snake trick or your water-to-blood trick. So Moses shows up again and says, well, let's have another one. And so now comes the third feat, and the third feat is, well, I'm going to call up frogs out of everywhere. Frogs are going to come from all over the place and just plague all of you. And so there again, frogs come, and well, we have a plague of frogs all over Egypt now, and all Pharaoh's a little upset and ticked off. His kids hate frogs, and there's frogs everywhere, frogs in the kitchen, frogs in the toilet, the bathroom. Frogs are everywhere. And then Jannes and Jambres do the same thing. They create more frogs. In other words, making the situation a little more worse than it already was, which is a good lesson to learn that the devil, even though he may have some power of some sort, he will always make the situation worse than it really is. I'm going to let that soak in a minute for those of you that want to buddy up with him. He will always appear religious, but he will make the situation worse than it already is. In other words, the water's blood, well, I'll just make it worse and give you more bloody water. And then here come the frogs, and well, I'll just make it worse and give you more frogs. So know this about the devil's power. His goal is to always make things worse. But in making things worse, he wants to impress you with his power. Whew, you gotta love the devil. He's a good one. I don't know if he ever shows up as a bush or not, but who knows. But anyway, Pharaoh says, not going to let the people go. So sorry, going to keep them around. Those don't impress me. My magicians can do the same thing that you can do. Now insert the final one that really throws Jannes and Jambres for a loop. Moses takes his stick and touches the ground, and the dust turns into gnats. You got to love that. It's almost like they were in South Georgia. And the gnats just come up from everywhere, plaguing everybody. And then Jannes and Jambres are like, this is the finger of God. We can't touch this. Makes me stop and scratch my head a minute. You can turn a stick into a snake, and you can turn water into blood, and you can make more frogs come. In other words, you can make everything worse. Well, why can't you make dust turn into gnats? And then you suddenly realize that is only the finger of God, because only God can truly change the nature of one thing into something completely different. Only God can do this. Only God could take a dust particle and turn it into a gnat, kind of like only God could take a dust particle and turn it into a human being. So now we're talking about a creative, only God kind of miracle. And this is what Timothy is all about. Paul is saying in 2 Timothy chapter 3, there are religious people who will do all kind of impressive things. They will appear godly, sound godly, talk godly, think godly, and well, maybe even act kind of religious, but they have zero power. Zero power to do what? To change the nature of who you really are. From a sinner into a saved person, from having eternal death into eternal life. And this is what Paul is saying when he talks about Jannes and Jambres being religious, and you should stay away from those kind of people because they cannot change the nature of who you are. And that's what Christianity is all about. It's not about just being religious and saying all the right things and the creeds and the formulas and the hallelujahs and the amens. Christianity is about being born again, becoming a brand new person, not a better you, a brand new you. Not an old you who quit all their bad habits, but a brand new you who is in the image of God. And that's the story of Jannes and Jambres. Even the devil has to stop at the ability to change you into a completely different person. The only thing the devil can do in his power is make you into a worst version of yourself. That's all he can do. A worse version of you. He will impress you, but he'll make you worse. But God doesn't just make you a better person. Because of Jesus Christ, he makes you a different person. Hope you enjoyed it.